hotline rumor for you. Spring is in the air, and apparently so is love. And this particular love affair, I can't say anything about on television. Folks, there is a new WCW champion, that belt having changed hands overseas. Attention, hotline fans, I'll have the report on this new belt holder in World Championship Wrestling all night long during my exclusive hotline report right on up until midnight tonight. Hey, attention, hotline fans, tonight, yes, tonight in Los Angeles, World Championship Wrestling unveils a secret weapon that may finally cause a rival wrestling organization to crumble. You will not see any of this unfold on television, but fans, this surprise will be available to you on the WCW hotline, and I have all the details. Last week, a major story broke involving this ex-WCW heavyweight champ, and I'll tell you what this big man did to get in a whole lot of trouble. Plus, a suspended executive talks out loud this past week, and man, did he have some interesting things to say. You know, officials at TBS get very jittery, very jumpy when I talk about rumors on the air. They will not let me talk about this one because it involves one of wrestling's all-time greats, the Ultimate Warrior. However, I will discuss it tonight on the hotline. Folks, last weekend at Slamboree in the backstage area, I overheard one of the greatest wrestlers of all time talking to a member of a competing organization about a plot that really thickens, a plot that would directly influence one of his best friends here at WCW. Hotline.
Skills and vocabulary too. Coming hits in the disedition is all brand new. You're through. I'm interplanetary and like Doctor Who. So who?
Fuck your beef, no relief. I step on stage, girls scream like I'm Keith.
What's up, everybody? Ringtime Pro Wrestling is in the building. Keith is riding solo. We are coming to you early. This is a Wednesday night special edition. We are going to preview Wrestle Kingdom. Wrestle Kingdom 13 is going down from the Tokyo Dome January 4th, which is a Friday. I forget the Japanese start time, but here in the United States, it translates to about 3 o'clock in the morning, Eastern Standard Time. I will be up. I will be live tweeting this from Ringtime Pro Wrestling and from my personal Twitter account, KHOPEJR. I love this time of the year. It is the first major wrestling show of the year. Now, and it kicks right into, gives you time for Royal Rumble, but you really get to see what's going on. New Japan finals out their year. This is WrestleMania for them. The Tokyo Dome is a huge show. They're on track to sell out. It's the second biggest wrestling show of any given year. Following behind WrestleMania. So, I'm here to talk. Today, the direction of the show changes a little bit. Because basically what we're going to do, we weren't going to really talk about anything other than New Japan, but there are some major news that has happened, so we're going to cover that all. To open up the show, if you heard the opening promo, it was the hotline with me and Gene. We're going to disperse a lot of me and Gene into this show. Today we learned me and Gene Oakland passed away at 76 years old. For those of you who are familiar, me and Gene put about 40 years in the business, starting in 1970, working for the AWA with Vern Gagne. He is literally the voice of my childhood when it comes to this professional wrestling. Me and Gene, he was the number one announcer as far as the backstage. Number one guy behind the scenes. So when it came to he's the voice of all promos. Your Savage promos, your Hogan promos, all of that is me and Gene. Right? Which is, like I said, the soundtrack of the 1980s. And he carried it on into the 90s and did a good 10 years at WCW. So, I mean, he did 10 or 12 years in the AWA, 10 years in the WWE, about 10 years in WCW, and held it down everywhere he went. I mean, the most famous line you hear any wrestler say, "Let me tell you something, me, Gene." So, it's so iconic, Kevin Hart used it in a Mountain Dew commercial. Because, I mean, it's a thing. Mean Gene served out the final parts of his career with the WWE. He had a Legends contract that he was on. You see it on the Legends House, the reality show that they had. So we're going to play a lot of Mean Gene. Some of the funnier interviews that we came across. And like I said, it's a somber day, but what we're going to do is we're going to celebrate the man who brought us moments. You know, hey, when Hulk Hogan won his very first title, he celebrated with Mean Gene. We got the audio here. If it goes, please don't play an ad.
Everybody likes flexibility, which is why at CarMax you can do as much or as...
Which I hate that YouTube plays ads for everything. Well, say that I hate that it plays ads for everything, but... Oh, sorry.
I feel the energy. Hulkamania is running worldwide.
I forgot to turn the audio on. This being my own engineer sucks, I tell you.
Gene Okun here with the brand new World Wrestling Federation champion, Hulk Hogan. You proved it to thousands and thousands of fans, not only here tonight in Madison Square Garden, but throughout the wrestling world.
You know something, Mean Gene? They proved it to themselves. All I asked was for the whole WWE to stand behind the Hulkster, and I told him I'd bring it home for the USA. You know something, Mean Gene? It is the dream of a lifetime, Daddy. Oh. And you know something? I can't imagine this is like going to the mountaintop a thousand times over. I feel the energy. Hulkamania is running worldwide, and it just turns me on, Mean Gene. And I felt every one of those 25, 30 plus thousand people with me standing behind me all the way, and it felt great.
Well, you have arrived, Hulk Hogan.
Have you never seen anything as beautiful as this, Mean Gene? This belt is part yours, too. It's everybody out there,
man. Oh, 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 what a... the new heavyweight champion of the world.
That's nice of you. I'm really proud of you. And you are a good wrestler. I'm proud of you.
Oh, the champagne is flowing. Ivan Putski.
Okay, baby. Hey, I'm proud of you, Jack. Oh. Very good, huh? Can you win?
It's Super Monday at the Garden with the new heavyweight champion, Hulk.
I just wanted to give y'all, like, just, you know, some of the best of Mean Gene. Hulk Hogan saying, hey, let me tell you something, Mean Gene. It's like the soundtrack of the 1980s. He knew how to push the heels when they would say something. He had the playful back and forth to Bobby Heenan, always letting Heenan have it, never giving him too much, never letting him get out of control. He was a master of the backstage. Yeah, he was a master of those promos that's hyping up. He hosted a lot of the favorite weekly wrestling shows where he wasn't necessarily the broadcast booth, but he'd do the intro like, hey, welcome to All-American Wrestling. He was the main studio guy and just a staple of professional wrestling. And BG will be missed. I think I got one more promo in the pipe that I'm going to play for some BG, and we're going to get into that. So, like I said, this show is about Wrestle Kingdom. But we got some news. We got some notes this week. We're not going to do birthdays because that just seems a little crazy. But what I'll say about it overall, this is an exciting time in the wrestling business. I thought 2018 was good. 2019 could be an explosion. All right. Right now, we have some things on the cusp. New Japan is making major inroads into the United States. They got a show coming in Charlotte, I think February 1st. Be on the lookout for that. Another United States show. So they're upping their shows that they're doing in the United States. That's big. Huge. Ring of Honor. Still going strong. Still the number two company in the United States on this side. Gotta love them. Their partnerships with working territories. Doing big business. Shout out to Court Bauer. MLW. Really blowing up. Word on the street. They just signed David Boy Smith Jr. of New Japan. That's where he's going to be working with Lance Archer mostly in New Japan. But now he's going to be signed with MLW. He's going to be putting in that work. MLW. Also, right now they're on BN TV, but they are attracting a lot of. Here's the thing: people want to be in the pro wrestling business. Heard there are talks with CBS. Who knows? One of the guys to look out for is Barrington Hughes down there, guy who I've been followed on social media. Cool guy. But yeah, MLW is doing some big things down there. Florida is the hotbed of wrestling. Right now, Florida is turning it out. Florida is where NXT is taped. Florida is where they tape a lot of Impact tapings. Florida is going to be the home of all Elite Wrestling. So we have all this discussion about the Elite. Where are they doing? The Elite trademark was filed. Tony Khan, co-owner of the Jacksonville Jaguars, son of the principal owner of the Jaguars, is going to be the guy running the show. So they have billionaire money behind them. Now, I want everybody to temper their expectations, to temper what they think. First and foremost, they have a billionaire behind them, but they don't have $1 billion at their disposal. This isn't WCW per se. And I always want people to temper their expectation because as soon as they hear about a billionaire getting involved in wrestling, they think, all right, somebody to box with Vince. What, you'll never box with Vince. This is Disney. This is ESPN. I feel like this. Fox Sports has done an amazing job building Fox Sports 1. And they have Fox Sports 1, Fox Sports 2. And they don't really have a lot of the satellite networks that they used to have, like the little small markets. But they have really done a major job revamping Fox Sports. And they're getting major contracts. They got people showing major games on there. And they showed on a regular Fox channel. The NFL does good. They got the UFC. They kicking ass. They are still number two in the sports market to ESPN. And it will probably almost always be that way. Anybody in professional wrestling right now, you will always be number two to the WWF or WWE simply because this is the way it is right now. Is there a chance for you to come up? Yes. But do not expect that to happen immediately. But what I will say is that people are on fire. And I think there's money coming back into the wrestling business after the SmackDown deal with Fox. I think a lot of other networks was like, oh, they willing to pay for that? There must be some eyeballs that's going to watch wrestling. And here's the thing about wrestling. The ratings haven't been as high, but they're steady and they're faithful. Wrestling fans are looking for an alternative also. So this is a big deal. Like I said, MLW has been talking with CBS, I believe. And with All Elite, they have been shopping major networks. Networks are interested. And the guys that they have going with them, the Young Bucks, Adam Page, these are guys who turned down WWE deals. It was known. The WWE was very interested in the Bucks. They were very interested in Page, for sure, I could tell you. And Cody, they want to bring him back home. Cody Rhodes, who may be the catalyst of this, and is going to be the vice president. It's amazing to see, and I wish Dusty was allowed to see this. So, this is Dusty's kid. This is a Dusty move. Dusty, as big as a star he was a star promoter also, right? Dusty did things in the wrestling game and the promotions that people had seen before. He's the concept of Starrcade. He is the visionary of War Games. Those kind of things, they're Dusty Rhodes creations. Now, the next evolution, the All In. Cody Rhodes has his fingerprint on that. They were able to sell 10,000 tickets, fill up a venue. Now, January 12th, Double or Nothing. They're going to be back. They're going to try to do it again. Now, they don't have ROH backing them, but they have themselves. They have the buzz. They have the right way to use social media, which they fully understand. I think these people are motivated to be special. They could have took big money deals with the WWF, but they decided to go on it their own. And I think that kind of risk-taking and that kind of thought process, I think is good, and I think that is the only way we're ever going to get some real competition. Do I think they will force the WWF have to change some practices? Not right away. But who I would be on lookout for if I was Impact Wrestling. If I was Impact Wrestling, I'd be sweating right now because there's nothing to say you guys won't fall off the map because there's another place coming in, and they're going to pay guys, and I think these guys, if they band together like a band of brothers, and look at it as like not so much as what I'm getting paid up front right now, but what this thing could be and what it could blow up to, I think you have the makings of something special. You really do. Like I said, Cody is showing off that his mind for this business is as incredible, and we didn't know that he had this in him. We just knew he was Dusty's kid, but he might be Dusty's kid in more ways than one. So I'm very excited to see what happens. The Bucks know the tag team wrestler don't go too far in the WWF. This is going to be good for them. It's a chance to make your own mark. A lot of people have just been marking their names on the wall to something that has a bunch of names already on the wall. This is a chance for them to make history. And that, not in like some figurative talk, but like real history with this. So, this is going to be interesting. Wait to see how it all turns out. But yeah, those are things that are going on in the wrestling world. And I want to get that out. And I'm going to cover it. Tessa Blanchard was named number 3 in Sports Illustrated Top 10. So, for 2018, Sports Illustrated named the top 10 women in professional wrestling. One thing I will say, 4 of those top 10 were not in the WWF or WWE. And I'm very proud of that because, once again, a lot of things are going on. Women's wrestling, like I said, will lead us into 2019. That will be probably the catalyst of where we follow things. WOW debuts January 18th on AXS TV. Tessa Blanchard will be a big part of that. Tessa being number 3 is huge because she has a similar opportunity. Somebody who participated in All In. Somebody who might be able to work with the Elite. She has a very unique pedigree. Tully Blanchard is her father. Her stepdad is Magnum T.A. Now, for those of you who are familiar with 80s Crockett area wrestling, that sounds crazy, right? It's like, whoo, that's going to tell your mom's baby doll. But it's time for that. Tessa, I've been watching her for some years. And she's very young. So when I met her, she had to be like 19 because they said she's only 23 now. The young lady repositioned, made her body to be more of a bodybuilder, really worked hard, and can hold her own. And extremely talented. Extremely talented. But her being number 3 shows that she has broken the mold. Like, number 2 was Charlotte Flair, and I want to say number 1 was Becky Lynch. And those aren't fair. Like, Becky Lynch dominated. Charlotte Flair is always going to be in that top 5 conversation as far as women in professional wrestling. But it wasn't close. I mean, it's just kind of like giving Ronda Rousey Rookie of the Year. Like, it's who it belongs to. But Tessa is tearing up the world in Impact Wrestling. The question is, will she ever come to WWE? Or when? I think in wrestling, there's always a win dynamic more than an if, just because the money becomes too great to ignore at some point. And I think a lot of people have that itch to know what would it be like to be on that other side. So, the Mania class really doesn't do it for you. I mean, that was just one round. And so, going out and being able to compete and show who you are at the highest level might make you stay around a little longer. But, you know, we'll see. Because, like I said, it could have a big money deal already in the works. The dream match is already there. Her versus Charlotte Flair. Or her teaming up with Charlotte Flair. However it works, but her versus Flair would be, you know, you could make a lot of stories out of that. So, shout out to Sports Illustrated for doing that list. Also, shout out to Sports Illustrated, CBS Sports, ESPN. Y'all all cover professional wrestling without me. I think your coverage would be better if I was involved. Just saying. China's mother wants her daughter inducted into WWE Hall of Fame. She said it's been too long. It's about time. This is what I will say. Eventually, China will make it into the WWF Hall of Fame. I think her accomplishments warrant being in that conversation. Because, you know, things did. But, yeah, so China wants, her mother wants her to induct to Hall of Fame. I think there just has to be more distance and time away from it. People have acknowledged her more and more. They've acknowledged her for her talent and her being a game changer, her being the first woman to do a lot of things, things that they probably won't ever allow a woman to do again in the WWF. But China has some asterisks about her. A lot of interviews, if you look her up, it just doesn't look good. The porn, per se, I don't think it's as bad, but it is a problem, right? Because if you put China wrestler in the Google search, now it comes up a little bit better, which is RIP and we miss her, yada, yada, yada. But prior to, man, it used to come up with, woo, hold on, red flag, too much. And I don't think they want kids catching that. Triple H made that point one time. Like, yeah, we can't have kids looking up that, being like, who, what's this? Now, from a more personal level, and he won't say this, but he can't have his daughters looking at that, wondering what's this. Also, he don't want his daughters to do any more in-depth investigation on the Google about all of this, because it's a story there, right? Like, I'm not there to get their personal relationship, but, you know, things happen, and somebody was with somebody, they wasn't with them no more, and somebody was stuck out there without one. So, no, no. But I think she'll get in. I just don't think it's time right now. And I just think they are trying to find a way to get it in, minimize it, not have people thinking about it. Because I think as time goes on, things do ease up. And find the right way to capture yourself. So, I got nothing other than that, man. I got nothing. But, and while I'm here talking about Hall of Fame, I saw a picture on the social media, you know, scroll down the timeline. Look, man, Chris Benoit ain't never getting into the Hall of Fame. Get over it. Please get over it. He's never getting in. And he should never get in. The way they have him right now at the comfortable distance that they have him at is fine. I'm not saying he wasn't a good wrestler because he was an excellent performer, but No. That is okay. So, with that being said, what I'm going to do, I'll give you a little BG. Then, you know what? I'm just going to give you over to the Elite. Let me do that, because that's probably what we all came here for. It's the Elite. And then we're going to talk some... There we go. We're going to talk some New Japan and preview Wrestle Kingdom. So, without further ado,
we have gone above and beyond. What a good guy and what a bad guy is. What is classical wrestling? I can tell you, it has a place in history. It's important for learning as a young educational student. But what are we? We are the Elite. We are the best on the planet. There is no good guy, no bad guy. There is no good, there is no evil, except for what is in our hearts. Yes. And what is in our hearts is this business that we love. So we will continue to own it. And we will continue to do it in our own very special way. And Tanahashi, oh yeah, I'm talking to you, you old fucker. You can't do anything about it. Your time is over. I run this promotion now. And when it comes to the world, you're looking at the best on the planet. Why? Not just because we're good. Oh, no. It's because of what's in here and what's in here. We do this for each and every one of you and for the good of professional wrestling. So grovel at our feet. Treat us like the kings we are. Ooh. In fact, let me go above and beyond that. Treat us. I'm going to say it.
What?
Treat us like gods.
Wow. Ooh. You said kings.
I did.
You said kings.
I did.
Too often, people trying to drive a wedge between the Bullet Club. Mm-hmm. I hadn't been in the Bullet Club for 1 second, and it's, who's the leader? Who's mad at who? What's going on with Adam and Kenny? No, whoa, no, no, no. This is Camelot. This is a round table. Mediocrity loves company, and so does magnificence, and this is fucking magnificent.
Yes. Camelot, Cody? How wrong you are. This is not Camelot, my friend. This is Valhalla.
Ooh!
Yes. Too sweet.
Too sweet that. Too sweet that.
Beautiful.
Young Bucks, you have more pressing issues elsewhere. Yes. Right. You are needed back in your home countries, my friend.
We are.
Give these people a message that they can remember you by.
Tokyo, Japan, we will be back soon. We have to go home and pop the houses and sell some more t-shirts. Yeah. We have to go get a pump at the gym, make love to our wives, and have a couple more children. But we will be back. We'll be back more hung. We'll be back with better gear. We'll be back with better sideburns and better hair. We'll be back to
more important,
tan, too, right?
More importantly, broken hearty, broken Matt, brother Nero.
Oh.
You cocksuckers.
Whoa.
We are coming for you.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
What if Mom watches this?
Yes. No punches. Please, God forgive me. But you know what?
What?
We are coming for you guys. Mm-hmm. April 1st. Yep. Lakeland, Florida. The best tag team on planet Earth. Versus you two, you pricks.
Too sweet.
Yeah.
Or
delete. Delete.
Too sweet.
Get the hell out of here.
The elite. The elite.
Break it down.
The elite. The elite.
Break it down.
Second time.
Oyasumi.
Sayonara. Goodbye.
All right. So we are back. And... this show will emanate from the Tokyo Dome in Japan, January 4th. 10 matches booked on the card. One pre-show going on with it. A lot of titles are on the line. A lot of storylines will get finalized. So, this is the 13th year that we've been doing Wrestle Kingdom. I probably jumped on about Wrestle Kingdom 9. Beauty of this now is that you can watch it on the app. So if you have a Fire Stick, or I'm pretty sure they must have it on Roku if it's on Fire Stick, you can download the New Japan app, log in with your login from New Japan World, or you can use the iPad app with the Chromecast. And basically, you type it in, log to a web browser, and then send it over through the Chromecast. That is probably how I'll watch it because I find it a little bit better than the Fire Stick app sometimes. But either way it goes, be ready at 3 a.m. Be ready to turn it on. NewJapanWorld.com is a good way to watch this. And we're going to go down the line. So, we're scheduled, there might be a pre-show match. Most Violent Players, MVP, which would be Togi Makabe and Toro Yuro and Ryu Suzuki. Ryu Suke Taguchi versus Yugi Nada, Jeff Cobb, and Dave Finley versus Chaos, which will be represented by Goto, Beretta, and Chucky T versus Suzuki Gun, which will be represented by Minoru Suzuki, Lance Archer, the aforementioned Davey Boy Smith, who we talked about at MLW, versus The Elite, which will have Hangman Page, somebody we talked about earlier also, Yuro Takahashi, and Marty Scurll. It is a gauntlet match for the number one contender spot for the never open weight six-man tag team titles. Now, you asking who will get that coveted spot? There's a lot of good choices in here. Jeff Cobb, I have gotten a chance to get familiar with. I think if y'all heard me talk about Jeff Cobb about 3 Japan shows ago, I was like, who the hell is Jeff Cobb? Why is he talking about it's good to see him. Good to see him out. And good to see him, you know, getting better. But, you know, things happen. Dave Finley's on the team. Chaos looks like a good... I got a feeling the Elite might win this. Hangman, Takahashi, and Skrull, they'll win, and then they'll face whoever has the belts. I don't know who has the belts right now, but that's what we'll go with. Why? No particular mathematical reason, so if I get this wrong in the morning, you got me. Right? Kota Ibushi will defend the NEVER Open Weight Championship against Will Ospreay. This one promises to be a very good match. Ospreay, loaded with athleticism. Ibushi, best friends with Kenny. I'll predict that Ibushi keeps the belt. I think he's been doing a good job representing. And I think he'll hold on to the belt. And I think he'll be Ospreay. Ospreay will be entertaining. There'll be a lot of flippy moves and all that, but I don't see Ospreay winning. So I'm going to go with Ibushi keeping his belt. Match number three, Suzuki Gunn, represented by Kanemura and El Desperado, will be taking on Roppongi 3K and Los Interlabres de Japón, which is Bushi and Tagaji, for the IWGP Junior Tag Team titles. I always go Roppongi 3K. Show and Yo been doing a lot, but I think the belts might stay at home. I think Integral Abe's, Suzuki Gunn will hold on to those belts and they'll be fine within their world, their little clubhouse or whatever. So that'll work. I'm just gonna go with Suzuki Gunn gonna keep those belts. The British heavyweight title is on the line. So Tomohiro Ishii will defend that belt against Zack Sabre Jr. Zack Sabre Jr. might have made one of the best decisions and not signing with the WWE after 205 Live. If he was even offered a contract, he might not have been offered. But I think he has a better chance for a star to rise. And I think he's going to win that British heavyweight title for no better reason than he's British. The belt did not come from there. I think other foreigners have won it. But I think somebody winning an award will help stabilize how people feel if they see something even that small. So I just totally went off script about something else. Sorry, everybody. No, Sabre. I think Sabre wins that match. Like, I think Sabre does a good job, and he wins that match. Potential one of the probably more entertaining matches of the night will be for the tag team titles. The current champs, Gorillas of Destiny, will take on Sonata and Evil, who won the World Tag League by beating G.O.D. and the Young Bucks. The Bucks are here. They stopped kind of competing for those junior tag team titles. They want the real tag team titles. They want the heavyweight tag team titles. I think this match will be interesting, but I think G.O.D. will submit themselves as the dominant team in this division for this organization, and they'll keep their belts. Hakusas ain't no jokes. And I like everything they've done so far, and I think they will maintain their belts. Next up, Cody Rhodes will face Juice Robinson. He will defend the IWGP U.S. Tag Team title. This will be interesting to see. So, this will be the rematch because Cody beat Juice a few months back. They've kind of held off on having their rematch. Cody had an impassioned promo after that match. You got to remember, Juice and Cody go back. Juice was at NXT for a little while, and Dusty was fond of him, and people called him Dusty's kid. Cody like, fuck that. I'm Dusty's actual kid. And y'all ain't got me out there like that. So, what's up? So, yeah. Things like that happen. But who do I like in this match? I think Cody might keep his belt. His belt. This is why. With the new promotion starting, I think him starting off as a champion, not just as a champion of promotion, but starting off as a champion, leaves a little bit of credibility to what's going on. So I'm going to say, yeah, Cody keeps for right now. But I do think Juice is on his way. And I think he's just going to challenge. But, yeah. But, okay. So, as we're getting late and I'm doing weird pauses for no reason, let's finish up this show. But yeah, I'm going to say Cody Rhodes keeps the belt. I could be wrong, but let's say Cody Rhodes keeps the belt. Kushida will take on Tajai Ishimori for the Junior IWGP Championship. Kushida's going to keep that. He's been having a good run, and his popularity is starting to soar. He is one to watch out for, too, because people are going to have rumors that this guy is probably on the defect. But, yeah, for right now, I say he'll keep his Junior Heavyweight Championship. So, I haven't really handed the belts over to anybody so far. There is a grudge match. Kushida Okada versus Jay White. Jay White, Switchblade. The self-appointed where he believes he's more of the leader of the new Grey Cup. Not Grey Cup. Playoff five. Yeah. I'm going to go to Okada. This is why. That man has sat on top of throne forever. I think where his stance is, not, he's not falling off. After 2 years of being a champ, he's not just falling off. I think it'll be a toughly contested match. I think it'll be interesting. It's going to be stiff, but I'm going to get an edge to Okada. IWGP Intercontinental title match. Chris Jericho versus Tetsu Naito. This one I think is easy. I don't think Jericho is going to be back that much. I don't think Jericho wants to deal with a full-time wrestling schedule. So he's not in the WWF. I think he liked the ability to put his thing in the garage. But I think for the most part, things will be out. Naito's going to win. Naito's going to beat Jericho. Jericho's been gallivanting around the world. He's been having a good time. But Naito is the consistent guy. He's the Japanese hero. He's going to get that belt. He's going to beat Jericho for that title. It'll be a good time. Then it's the main event. Kenny Omega versus Tanahashi. Kenny Omega finally overcoming the hump. Finally beating Okada. Finally getting that new Japan world title. He's been a custodian for about 8 months or so. Very talented. Can't wait to see how it all goes down. But I think Kenny Omega keeps the belt, right? At least for now. And I don't know what happens after the show. But I think Kenny Omega keeps the belt. Tanahashi is very talented. Tanahashi will go down to the Hall of Fame. He'd be one of the greatest guys to ever lace up the boots over there. Only problem is that the guy got stuck one time and it just, I don't know, it all goes bad. But I feel like this is the passing of the torch. He's beat Okada, now beating Tanahashi at Wrestle Kingdom says, we think you're the man. And I'll go with that. I'll go with Kenny Omega, the man. And with that being said, I think that's it. So, a quick rundown again. I have the Elite winning the Gauntlet match. I got Ibushi, Kota Ibushi retaining his never open weight title. Suzuki Gunn will keep the junior tag team titles. Even though it's kind of hard to go against Roppongi 3K. Is that division reminds me of how the Bucks had it when they were in that division. Like, they're always on the count. They could be coming for it. So, I guess look out for that. I think Ishii defeats Zack Sabre. No, I'm sorry. I did not think that is the opposite of what I had. I said Sabre beats Ishii because he's going to take that British Heavyweight Championship from him. And since he's British, I'll go with it. Gorillas of Destiny will retain their titles. Cody, I just said Cody was going to beat Juice, and I take that back. I think Juice is going to beat Cody. I think this is more of Juice on his extension. I think Juice beats Cody, right? And then Cody doesn't have that belt while he's dealing with New Japan. And that's fine. We can all work around that. So, Juice Robinson. I'm going to twist my pick. Juice Robinson for United States tag team, for United States title. Kushida will retain the junior. Okada will beat Jay White in a single. Naito will defeat Jericho and take the IWGP title from Jericho. And because you can't have really two in one day, I'll say Kenny Omega retains too. And that's it. That's my nutshell. So like I said, I'm going to be live tweeting this. So I will be online a few minutes before the show starts. Be ready. I'm taking a nap as soon as I get home, so I'll be up and alert during the whole thing. Be drinking a little coffee, maybe a little bit of Crown Caramel Apple. I don't know, but I have a good time. And I expect y'all to have a good time, and I appreciate y'all listening. And we will be back probably next week with something to do with Royal Rumble and that kind of thing. So with that, we are out.